Hello everyone and welcome back to Laurence Plays Factorio Space Exploration. It's been a busy few hours in this game recently, and one of the things I've had is another attack from a coronal mass ejection, and I've actually recorded that as a separate video. So let's stick that in here now, and we'll run through that and see what happened. So we started off with the seeing the warning was there and looming for me, and so as you can see here, it tells me how much. It tells me about the attack that's about to come. It's 2.2 gig peak power, 182 gigajoules, yada yada yada, and it's about to hit. So I thought, okay, I'll check on my defences, make sure they're actually going to be capable of dealing with that. So over here we have the umbrella defence, and if I hover over that, then as you can see, it says it's capable of it's capable of, one unit is capable of defending up against up to 500 gigajoules of attacking power. So that's far more than I was being threatened with. So that's absolutely, that seems to be absolutely fine. The attack hits, the umbrella defense lights up in blue, like this, and it's working. Nothing's exploding yet, so that's going quite well so far. I was having a bit of a look around. And to be honest, I wasn't really expecting anything too exciting to happen here. I thought I'd record it anyway, just in case, because, you know, it's something different that was going to happen, and happens fairly rarely, so it seemed worth recording. However, yeah, as you can hear, suddenly it turned out it wasn't going so well, and this coronal mass ejection had actually struck ground here. So the it turns out it wasn't working quite as well as I was expecting. It's doing a load of damage there, and there's a few others hitting in other places, mostly outside my base area, but one is doing a fair amount of damage. And now I can't actually see the umbrella defense anymore on the radar. Now that usually means, when radars go down, it usually means there's power problems. This was a bit of a clue as to what was going on and why things were having problems. I was unfortunately way down at this uranium mine at the time, doing some expansion against the biters. So I quickly got my train to take me back up there. Well, fairly quickly, got my train to start taking me back up there. Programmed it to not run away once it dropped me off, because they have a habit of doing that. One of the things Vanilla or Factorio does by default is when you have when you set a temporary stop for a train, it will only stay there for 5 seconds and it will clear off again. That's quite frustrating, because I almost always want the train to just wait there. Fortunately, that mass ejection is just lurking around in an empty area at the moment. I don't know why the things being destroyed alert is still going off, because they aren't. They weren't at this point. I think it was just trying to catch up. It hadn't had a chance to make that noise enough times yet. So I came over, had a look here. This area seems to have been split off from the power system for the rest of the base, which is a bit odd, because I thought I'd link practically everywhere up. So that was the first clue something was wrong. I think that, with hindsight, I think that might have been some of the pylons being destroyed up on the top side where things were being destroyed by the mass ejection. So I then came over, had a look at this one as well, see how that was doing. Same sort of thing, bit split off. But then when I got over, I think it was this, when I got to here, is this the right one? Yes, here we go. So this is this is actually showing the main base's issues. Also, there's one of the trains that's gone and carried stuff through. I'll talk about why that was in a moment. Let's have a look at the power supplies again. Come on, bring it up. There we go. And no, the other way. Let's go down to 10 minutes. Okay, so on this one, I'll pause it here, because this shows exactly what went wrong with the umbrella defense. As you can see from the orange trace on the left, when the umbrella defense kicked in, it spiked up to about 1.2 gigawatts of power being sucked in by it. That was sort of okay. Looking on the right, you can see the green spike is from the accumulators producing that much power, along with the blue from that's from the nuclear plants, and the solar panels, and the orange as well. So between them, they were able to keep it going for a few seconds. Now at 1 gigajoule, the 14 gigajoules in my accumulators was ripped through in about 14 seconds with the amount of top up that was coming from the rest of the system. So that meant very quickly the umbrella defense sucked the accumulators dry, and then there just wasn't enough power in the base to keep the umbrella defense going at the amount of power required to deal with the coronal mass ejections. So that meant all the radars went down because there was a power shortage. Everything went down because there was a power shortage, and the including the umbrella defense. And so the fireballs from the mass ejection managed to break through and start doing damage. So yeah, that's a bit unfortunate, as you can imagine, and led to basically everything just getting blown up there in that northwest corner of the base. And because there was no power, the trains weren't getting unloaded properly either. So they pull into a station, and there was no power, so the inserters wouldn't be running, which is why we then saw those trains ending up back in the depot with all of their with full loads. So that's another thing that needs to be sorted out from this general mess. And of course, because I left my artillery train in the middle of the tracks, there's a bit of a gum up from all of that as well. So I called the construction train out and jumped in that and went off to go and do some repair works, headed up to the site of all of the destruction. Now, as predicted, I'd lost some pylons along here. I don't know if that was what had split up the various different areas. I need to go and check that on the map, I think. But it definitely needed some repair work doing. So I trundled up there and then, you know, just got the bots to do it. That's what they're there for, right? That wasn't too difficult. Now, one of the updates, slightly frustratingly, has changed the size of some of the bounding boxes on some of the trees, I think. So occasionally when something gets destroyed, I can't put it back exactly where it was without going in and knocking out a tree first. But because the game expects the tree to have already gone, the bots won't do it automatically. So that's like this. So that's a little bit annoying. So just come in and remove the trees like that, and then I can actually put the belts down. It's only mildly annoying, though. It's not too bad. It could be more of a problem if things get destroyed when I'm not around and keeping an eye on the bots that are trying to do the building work, of course. But it's generally not too much of an issue. So that's that sorted out. Once that was done, I then spent a bit more time actually down on the main planet. So let's have a look at that. So one of the things I looked at, I checked out on the Informatron. It says here that the next mass ejection that I'm going to get, which is going to be in about 14 hours, is expected to be 2.2 gigawatts peak power, 182 gigajoules total. So once I'd realised that the problem was a lack of power, I started laying down a lot more accumulators. So we've got these massive banks of them here. I'm not sure what this is. So it's on about 2 gigajoules before, I think. No, 14 gigajoules. Now I've got up to 22. But I need to get that up to 180. So that's going to be an absolutely enormous area of these things. But I guess in order to defend against that attack, that's essentially what I'm going to have to do. Producing the power isn't an issue. The nuclear power plant is... What sort of power is that running at the moment? Switch over to slightly longer term. Okay, so actually my nuclear power plant isn't quite enough. As you can see here, over a slightly longer period, it's running absolutely flat out here. You can tell because it's a dead straight line. And then the accumulator here in green is making up the little bit extra that it needs when the solar panels are offline. The solar panels are doing the standard chonk, chonk, chonk as it gets light and dark. So they're producing as much as they can. And then we've got this bit from the nuclear plant, and then a bit of a top-up from the accumulator. So I think what I'm going to need to do is build another nuclear power plant. But this is absolutely fine in normal times. I've got essentially this area up here is the spare power I have available that can be chucked into the accumulators and then pulled out as necessary. So that's quite a lot of power. But if I'm going to start needing huge amounts of power for the umbrella defense, it's going to be a little tricky. So I don't quite need another nuclear power plant yet, but it's getting to the point where it's something to consider. So that's the accumulators defend against that. I've also sort of been round the edge and pushed the biters back again, because I found I was getting a lot of places, especially sort of along the bottom of here, where I've got this is along the bottom of the base. I don't know how well you can tell from this view, but there's the wall and the turrets and things. And every so often the biters sort of sneak up. They put in some new nests like this one, and then there'll be a few attacks of varying sizes. And occasionally they'll manage to knock out a few turrets. And this area isn't covered by roboports because it's just too big for that, really. And so it doesn't get replenished. And the biters gradually creep back closer. So it's the defense is. Can't quite keep up with what comes in from here. I could come along and just make it solid turrets like I have here, and that would probably help. It certainly would help a bit, but there's still the fact the biters expand means the problem just gets gradually worse and worse until I go down there with the artillery train and blow them all back out away again. The same sort of thing was happening over here on the right hand side. So again, I've gone over with the artillery training and cleared them all out a bit. Next thing was I was discovering I was starting to run out of iron as well, so I built up a couple of new iron mines. What's this? Whatever this is. This is a nearly dead iron mine, so this is probably, this sort of thing is the reason why I was running out of iron. That they're practically, the mines are just starting to run out. But I found some iron patches. Is this one? Yes, I found some iron patches up here. I've claimed this one and this one. So I've got two new iron mines digging it up now. And they've got, well, this one's got 34,000 and this one's got 39,000. Those aren't great amounts, but they're enough to keep it ticking over. And if I have a look down here in the smeltery, it's around here somewhere. Here we go. Then you can see, yeah, the copper and the iron is getting fairly constantly unloaded here. But I do have 165,000 of that, 172 of that one, 172 of that one, and 160 of that one, but it is actively getting loaded at the moment. So all of those have got quite a lot of the supplies in them. So this is all basically okay. I just need to keep on top of pushing the biters back from time to time. So the exciting part, the bit you're probably actually waiting for, is up here on my space base, for want of a better word, where I've done a bit of expansion and actually got to the point where I'm producing rocket science. It turns out it is rocket science. It is quite difficult. Rocket science is quite difficult there. That's what I was trying to say. So beforehand, in the last episode, I think I got to about here maybe. So I've got these manufactories building up the thermofluids, the coolers, what's this one making? Oh, supercomputers, and the orange goo. We then have these substrates being made that we can then turn into essentially memory sticks. Those are passed down over here into this computer, which puts some sort of space-related data on them. That comes out of that, produces it by magic. Those go on to those go on to another belt here, where they're fed into this machine here, which builds up the actual rocket science packs. Now, just to make things a little bit more difficult, the recipe for rocket science changed while I wasn't in an update. So I got this built up with the diagram that I've shown you a couple of times. But now, instead of requiring solar panels and scaffolding, it now requires these orange things instead, which are not these things. They're not rocket control units, which I had, and I brought a huge supply up, and now they're completely useless. They are instead satellite data units or something. I don't know what they're called. I can't find them and I don't know what they're called. But they look like that, but orange. And it turns out those are an extra thing that you have to make in your satellite, essentially, when you launch your satellite. So what we've got back on Nauvis again, if I bring that back up. Now I've set my normal rocket to launch basically as often as it can. Where is it? Here it is. And then this spits out those orange things, as I've forgotten the name of. They go up the belt here, and then they're another thing that's being fed over to here and being fed into the rocket. And as you can see, the belt is completely empty. All the ones that have been made are being fed in there. So that is working. We're getting them up here. As you can see, there's a load of them here, but it's an extra thing I have to do. I now need to launch actual satellites in order to get one of the things I need for rocket science. So, you know, another hoop to jump through. Those then get passed out along here, and they also come out with the used data cards as well. So the data cards are then passed around here into this machine, which attempts to recover them. Some of them are recovered. They come down here, down the belt over here, and they're fed back into the system over here. And the way I've got this arranged, they'll drop in on the bottom side of the belt, so they'll go across here, and then they'll be used in priority. So we'll use those ones up first before we use the new ones that are made by this machine. That's okay. It also sometimes produces broken cards, which currently I made a bit of a mistake here. I fed them down here and put them onto the scrap bus down here, which takes them back over and puts them in this chest here. However, there's an extra stage you need to go through with these. I can either do that up here, or I can take them down to the planet and do it there. But they can eventually just be turned back into useful things. So if we'll have a look at the data card, broken data card, there we go. So when I try and recover the junk data cards, there's a 70% chance of getting a blank data card, and a 29% chance of getting a broken data card, and a 1% chance of it just disappearing into the ether. That's interesting. And that gets turned into scrap, which then, as we saw before, gets turned into the various types of resources here. Or landfill, interesting. Or I can make a delivery can encapsulate it, probably at some point in the future. Anyway, so yeah, so that comes from the broken data cards, Yeah. So there are byproducts, and byproducts are always a bit of a headache to deal with, as we've discovered. However, I do now have an enormous quantity of this rocket science that's being produced quite nicely, coming along here, and I've also brought up a load of the other sciences from the ground, because when you're doing research, you need to have all of the science modules for the thing you're researching in the same science machine. You can't have some in one down on the ground and some in another one up here. So I've got these four belts, feeding them all into these space science labs. So I can now basically do any of these sciences that take the space science. Let's do this one because it looks like a Christmas tree. That feels strangely appropriate, although it won't be by the time this episode's actually released. So that is working, as you can see. I've only brought up enough efficiency modules for one of them. That's a bit of a mistake. I should put some more in the rest of them as well. And that's something I'll bring up with me soon. But what this does is quite nice, is they get fed along here into these machines, and then the bots keep these chests full, so they'll keep passing them out there. It keeps the bots busy, which is nice. Now, a bit of a problem I'm having around here is that it's the barrels again. Actually, that's fewer barrels than I thought. Maybe I've done something. What have I? Interesting. I thought I had a big problem with the sheer quantity of barrels I had up here, but it's actually not that many. Every time I go back to the planet, I've been taking some back with me. And I guess what it's been is I've had problems a number of times with just missing some of the resources up here. So the first time it was because I didn't have enough belts, I think, or enough underground belts. So I brought some more of those up, and that's tied me over a bit. But it still wasn't enough. I had to go and get some more of them. Then there was the shock of having to get these orange things. Where are they? What are they actually called? I can't just call them the orange control modules. Satellite telemetries. Okay, those things. I had the problem of not having any of those, so I had to go back down to the planet, get it to learn to produce that, and get those being fed up here as well. But overall, the general system is working quite well. I've got all of these linked together now with the cables, as you can see. This is taking the signal down to the planet. If I can get the right thing there. And then down here, we've got the signal being received and piped over here, so we can get the right amount of stuff into the rocket. And from this, you can see that belts are in high demand, as always. The substrate, the scaffolding is in high demand. We need a lot of glass, copper, iron. Water's not a huge amount of that, actually. Maybe I've got to a point where I've got enough water. And, of course, lots and lots of science packs are being taken up there, because they're getting used up by the research. So they'll probably get gradually, more of those will trickle in. Speaking of the science packs, I've not done anything particularly clever with that. I've just got these really long belts now that are carrying them up from wherever they're produced, and then just bringing them all the way up to the rocket, because it seemed easier to do that than to try and make more rockets further down at the bottom. And yeah, it's working. That is all working fine. Oh, here's some satellite telemetry. It's finally coming through. The area I am having a bit of a problem is with rocket fuel. Now, that's being made... Oh, interesting. I've run out of vulcanite. That's surprising, because I thought I had... That was blocking this up at one point. But I guess I've ripped through so much of that making rocket fuel now that I've got a shortage of it. It's clearly time for me to go off and discover more planets where I can get rocket fuel a bit faster, because this is now an issue. Oh dear. But yeah, the rocket capacity is still plentiful for taking up all the stuff I need. As you can see, it's less than half full, and I haven't felt the need to launch it yet. The problem I have run into now is that everything around the edge of it is basically full. I can't put any more different things in it. Actually, technically, there's one gap there because of the rocket fuel being fed in here, and I could probably spaghetti this pipe out a bit so that it went down here and allowed me to get another belt in there. But basically, I've got about as many different things being fed into the rocket as is reasonably possible, so I'm going to have maybe another rocket. I did read something on the internet, somebody else who's been playing this, and they said they had one rocket per resource, so they had them automatically launching as soon as whenever they were full and they needed. So they'd have one for steel, one for iron, one for copper, one for sulfur, and so on. A different rocket for every single one of these. Now, they've obviously got a much bigger base than me and a much higher throughput, so that's something I may end up doing in the future, but definitely not yet. So that's sort of the state of where I am at the moment. The rocket fuel and apparently the low-density structures are a bit of a problem. I think that's down to the copper supply. Yeah, this copper supply looks a bit unhealthy. So I think I did drop in red belts going all the way up to somewhere for copper to get a bit more copper through. Now the question is that has that actually upgraded everywhere, or is it limited now because the red belts aren't taking? Yeah, so this red belt isn't full because I actually don't know. Oh, maybe it's because this ran out. And so now a train's unloading here. So that's filled the red belt up, so it's catching up a bit now. So that's going to get better at least. But yeah, it's a bit of a problem that I'm struggling to pump enough copper through. So we'll have to take a look at that. And as we've seen, the vulcanite is also a serious problem, and I only get that from my core mining drills over here at the moment. So whilst those are running quite happily, they're producing vulcanite and everything else, they're not really producing enough of it, so we're going to need more of that. Now what I am aware of is that some of these planets, yeah, so like Myokin here, that has lots of vulcanite available on it, and a few other things as well, like uranium and beryl. Beryl might be quite nice, that might be useful, I don't know. So I can now try and pick out various different planets that have got the things I want. Tsukimi sounds like some sort of sushi, but has vulcanite, and it has one of these weird pyramid things on it that I was curious about. Tulip is producing vitamelange. That sounds organic. So yeah, there's lots of different planets producing lots of different things, and I've got various orbits and things, and yeah, so I can go off and look for the various different things from where that I need. And so presumably what I'll do is I'll put a rocket together with appropriate things, including another rocket to bring me back again, and go off to Myokin or Tsukimi and build up a large base there that does nothing but produces rocket fuel and presumably has some sort of defense from the biters as well, I guess. It's going to be needed too. And we'll just pump out rocket fuel, load it into a rocket, and send it off to wherever I feel I need it, which is probably going to be Nauvis first, and then take it from there elsewhere. So now I'm going to have to start thinking about shipping more stuff around by rocket and also building up these massive facilities on other planets to deal with it. And then of course they're going to get attacked by biters, and that's going to mean I'm going to have to go off and look after them, and oh dear, this is all going to turn into a bit of a headache, but I guess we'll see how it goes and try to keep on top of it all and keep things ticking over nicely. So I think that's going to be my next project, I guess. I've got this to the stage where, as discussed, it's working, it's producing the rocket science, and the research is happening over here. That's all good. That's all working nicely. And I have to admit, I'm not quite sure what to do next. I've been looking at the research and going, I don't know what any of this is for. But if I'm going to go off and get some beryl, then I'm going to need to look at beryllium processing and dealing with this and working out what to do with it. Apparently it's corrosion resistant and radiation resistant. That sounds useful. I could bump up, get some more projectile damage. That'd be quite nice. Then the guns will work slightly more effectively against the biters. Take that one as well. Oh, worker robot speed, that'd be nice too. So yeah, there's plenty to do. It's just working out what the things are to do. So yeah, I hope you'll come back and join me for the next episode, where I shall be probably going off to have a look at a new planet. We'll see how it goes though. I might have had a huge number of fires to fight before then. But we'll see how it goes. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.